that there's nothing to go back to at all.
Stay still, stay quiet, hide, don't tell her.
Their gods consumed your mind. They will use this power to destroy.
Vamos a hacer esta definitivamente sexta parte, que ya les como la llamo yo. Primer encuentro con ella. Y nos vamos ahí. Vamos, este vídeo lo voy a hacer hasta encontrar la espada. Y así no son vídeos muy largos los que yo pretendo hacer. Bueno, muchas gracias por estar ahí. Y aquí os voy a decir lo que voy a hacer. Hay que encontrar estas tres claves que hay aquí. Es fácil, ahora lo veréis. Para los que hayan entrado nuevo en Hellblade, el mayor problema lo pueden tener. Vamos a leer esto, la runa. Todavía hay otra runa más aquí que nos vamos a encontrar. Pero el mayor problema que aquí, en este puzzle, nos podemos encontrar es subir a los pisos de arriba. Y para eso tenemos que habilitar, como todo esto es una ilusión, una escalera que vamos a ver desde aquí. La vamos a concentrar y la vamos a... Esta que está aquí. Ahora la vamos a activar. Ya está. Y ahora buscar las señales. Fácil. Aquí hemos tenido antes unos combates bastante trepidantes. Bueno, pues ya está. Yo os voy a dejar con el vídeo. Espero que os guste y cualquier pregunta que tengáis, aquí me tenéis a vuestra disposición, bien de este juego de Hellblade, El Sacrificio de Senua, o de cualquier otro juego, siempre y cuando yo conozca el juego, claro. Pues nada, aquí os dejo con esto, que espero que os guste, amigos.
Pella possesses large dwelling places in Helheim. Tall are her walls, high are her gates. The name of her dish is hunger. Her knife is famine. On her threshold all will stumble. Her bed is called sick bed, and her bed hangings are called flames of a funeral pyre. They say she is easy to recognize, half black and half the color of flesh, and her face menacing and grim.
Showing weakness. You're not a warrior, you're a disgrace. The gods will punish you for this. Pick up the sword, pick it up, fight the darkness, fight it. Get up. Get up. Get up and fight.
Stormy seas and lost souls. She's dreamt of this before. They say dreams are visions of our memories, thoughts, and fears, as seen by our inner eye. But what if each one of us is always dreaming, even when awake, and we only see what our inner eye creates for us? Is this what hell is? A world shaped by Senua's nightmares. Maybe that's why people feared seeing the world through our eyes. Because if you believe that Senua's reality is twisted, you must accept that yours might be too.
You failed the gods. You're pathetic. rotten, cursed. What were you thinking? Did you really think you could win? How stupid can you be?
So stupid.
Everyone hates her. She's cursed.
The shadow hates.
Look at you. A warrior. Worthless. Weak. Pathetic. Go on. Feel sorry for yourself, because there's no one left to do that for you. Take it. If you're too much of a coward to fight, then end the suffering. Broken and lost. Just like your sword.
Come on. There.
Why go on, when you give everything and face that which torments you, only to find that it is worse than you could have imagined? Why go on? Is it really so weak to ask this? Or are we just so afraid of the honest answer that we do not dare pose the question? Sometimes the answer lies in a memory, a feeling. Song.
It's not real. It's a trick. It's not real. Listen to it.
She can't give up.
Day. It's
not like this.
It's not real. It's real. It's a trick. Don't trust it. Maybe you're already dead.
Who are you?
Do you still believe in yourself?
Before she first met him, she was not in a good place. She was a teenager, but not like the others. Barely functioning, she rarely left the house. Her father, Zinbal, made sure of that. Only occasionally did she venture out on her own, collecting firewood and herbs, errands out on the Orkney Plains. That was her world. Like this one. Barren. And lonely.
His father's hall was built around a great tree, and one day, Odin comes and thrusts a sword into the tree, a gift to whomever can release it. Many try, but the sword only comes out as Sigmund's touch. His brother-in-law, King Sigmund, wants it, but Sigmund refuses it. Sigmund and his brother seems certain. But the king's wife is Sigmund's sister, and she begs for mercy and implores the king to chain them up instead. He agrees. Not for mercy, though, but because he plans an even more cruel and lingering death. Chained to a tree in the forest that night, a she-wolf comes and devours one of Sigmund's brothers. She returns, ravenous, night after night, until only Sigmund is left. The next day, Sigmund's sister sends a servant with honey to smear on Sigmund's face. But why? Sigmund's face. He bites the wolf's tongue, The she-wolf pulls away, but Sigmund holds on. The chains break, and he is free.
What's your name?
Senua.
I haven't seen you before.
I'm not. I don't leave home much.
Oh. Zeno's daughter.
I have to go.
Wait. Who taught you to fight like that?
No one.
No one?
Well, I watched you, and...
You... learned all of that from watching me? You should become a warrior, you know.
Me?
I'm Dilly. I'm here for the warrior trials. You should come and watch. And bring your sword.
You can't put it into words. That moment when you look into the eyes of the one who's supposed to reassure you. Make you feel safe. It only takes an instant. Fear swallows you before you have a chance to make sense of it. And darkness becomes a part of who you are. But her world changed the day the Norsemen took him from her. Senua knows that there's no going back to how things were. That there's nothing to go back to at all.
Stay still, stay quiet, hide in the dark.
Their gods can see into your mind. They will use this power to destroy you.
They won't stop me. I can still feel him.
Whatever's left of him, they will never let him go.
I'm not gonna let him rot here!
You're the one rotting here.
Leave me alone.
You will die here.
No!
And all your suffering will have been for nothing.
Shut up!
Sigmund's sister trades shapes with a sorceress, and in disguise, she lies with her own brother. She gives birth to a son named Sinfjotli. After a time, she sends him to the forest to Sigmund. He tests the boy and finds him strong. About a god of the Northmen called Baldur. The second son of Odin. He was beautiful, good and wise. He was fair of feature. He spoke fair words. He gave fair judgments. Light shone from him. Only good things were told of him. Yet he was the first of the gods to die.